My name is Jerry Tracy, and I was asked to start this taking Paul Katz's place, and that's quite a letdown, I know. But if we wait for Dr. Katz, he ain't coming today. I'm just going to give you some very introductory remarks. We are obliged to show this. We have no commercial interest or ties to anything. This is in honor of Patty Vanston. The agenda tonight, you're going to be lucky. Jack Pryor is going to speak on health care reform. He is going to explain the entire issue, I thought in 10 minutes, but I understand a little later than that. You may ask, why are we talking about that tonight here? And the reason is the forms that we ask you to fill out, the evaluations, many put down that they would like that topic addressed. That's why it's being addressed. Then the important part of the program, I think for those of us who are clinicians and not theoreticians, would be Valerie Weber. Dr. Weber is head of medicine and the head of clinical science, and she's going to give part two of a very excellent talk she gave before, only now more scholarship, and we're getting closer to the time when we're going to have the third year students with you. Now, objectives, the first three objectives, I hope that these agree with Dr. Pryor, because they are health care reform as it relates to Medicare, as it relates to curriculum, and as it relates to you as a provider. The last four are Dr. Weber's, and it's basically good teaching. We always have to show the mission. We're very proud of the fact that we try to stay to this mission statement. It's simple, it's direct, and I think it's very good. Now, a few welcome, in fact, a lot of welcomes. We have a new physician in family practice who's got about 12 jobs already, and she just came here on Thursday. That's Dr. Joyce, and she's in the back, and she has joined us from Kentucky. Do you mind standing up so folks will know who you are, Dr. Joyce? So it's very good to have her, and Janet Townsend is even happier to have her. Now, the other ones you pretty well know, so I won't ask them to stand up, but I do want to mention Dr. Weber has been instrumental in this, and that's trying to add faculty to help with the administration of third year. And she may touch on this. I don't know if she is or not, but she's done a great job, and these are the folks who are coming forth. Now, I want to emphasize, there's plenty of room for everybody to help. Okay, this, please, please, and I'm going to mention that a few times. Education Director, we have Chris Onizio in medicine, Brian Wilcox in OBGYN, Mark Fratelli will be in surgery, Dr. Joyce, whom I've just introduced in family medicine, and psychiatry, our friend Dr. A.C. Patel. And then Clerkship Director, Lisa Thomas. I don't see Lisa tonight, but Lisa is from Scranton. And we also have coordinators, including Wazik Mirza in medicine, Jan Sternberg, who is here tonight, he's from Hawley, Harold Davis I saw come in also, Sanjay Chandragiri in psychiatry, Dave Onofre, and Kate Tighe in pediatrics. Okay, class of 2014, this is a real pleasure to talk about these folks. We have now two classes, and the most important bullet point is the last bullet point. They are now in class. We have about 170 students running around in 24,000 square feet. It's as crowded as I think it could be, but nevertheless, it's working fine as of this point. I'm going to take you a little bit through what happened. We had an orientation. This is the class photo. Everybody's happy, pleased, well adjusted, and I hope they stay that way. Most of the time, they do. Then we have the pledge ceremony, where they sign the oath. It's sort of a modification of the Hippocratic Oath. And we had orientation, and I am happy to announce that we survived Camp Lidore for another year. This is Dr. D'Alessandri. I could say it, he's not here. This is his pet baby, and you go out in boot camp like the Marines, and you try to get through it. We did. I can't wait till next year. All right, I'm just going to fly through this one. This is the 25 students first year who are with us now, and many of you are going to get to know them fairly well. I'm just going to point out a lot of things. There's, first of all, a lot of diversity in many ways, and diversity with respect to schools, but we still have about 70% are from Pennsylvania, keeping with our mission statement. Top right, this young lady is going to be out to Honesdale, so when I talk to Dr. Sternberg about, she's from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. These two, the right top, I'll just point out, this is Eleanor Gillis, the first one we had from the United States Military Academy. She's had a very outstanding record there. The other places were from that very famous institution, the University of Scranton, there on your right. Then we have, University of Richmond was popular. I interviewed about four students from Richmond. I was surprised, but several of them came. It's just that we seem to be pretty popular now in the South. Then we have another Richmond student, and Pittsburgh is highly represented. And then the top two, Matthew Myers, folks are from Scranton, he's the University of Pennsylvania. And then on the right is Ann Mashura, she's from Syracuse, also from Scranton. And she went to the famous bus that we rode around on 2 years, which none of us will ever forget who did it. And rounding it out, five more. And again, just notice the schools they're from, Wesleyan, Bryn Mawr, New York University, Pittsburgh. So we're very, very proud of this class also. All right, the community experience, which will be alluded to, I'm sure, later. We're going to start next week. Starts the second year students. Again, they're going to be with their primary care mentors for part of the week, the clinical preceptors for a part of the week, and the clinical health research project directors part of the week. The second year students start on October 24th. We're going to sign an affiliation agreement on the 19th of this month with Honesdale, and we're going to try to incorporate that rotation too. We'll see how it goes. Now, the application process. We, remember, did not get into the game, so to speak, until half the recruiting season was over for the first class. Therefore, we had 1,300 applications, and we interviewed 400. But look at the GPA, 3.5 and top quarter. So we had a great first-year class. The question was, could we sustain the effort? If you look to the second class, lo and behold, we were just shy of 3,000 students applied. The GPA stayed the same, about 3.5, again, top quarter. Now, I could tell you what's happening as of last night. Whoops, you have it in there, 3,320. So we have over 3,320 applications as of now. Where we're going to go, I don't know. I do want to point out the interviewing process. I'm just going to say a word on that when I get there. Now, I love this one. We're trying to show you a virtual video that Brian Krause has made, which was really spectacular. Incidentally, we had a gala on Friday. Some of you were there. For those of you who weren't, you missed one of the best parties I've ever been at. I would advise you to sign up for next year's because I think it's going to be in the new building and it's going to be spectacular. We had overflow crowd at this one with a waiting list for the one we just had. This is the East Tower. Yeah. And this is where the library and the student facilities are and the lounges and the administrative offices. The center and then to the left is the West Tower. I've said this before and I'm very happy to say it again. The architectural firm which is designing this reportedly is the best architectural firm in the world designing medical facilities. And you're going to be knocked out when you see this. Hopefully, Dr. Weber is planning and a few of us, hopefully we're going to have a faculty development meeting in here in April. I really, really want you to see it. I saw it once and I said I do not want to go back till it's finished. It is smashing. It is magnificent. So I just get very excited. It doesn't take much to excite me, but this really does excite me. Okay. Now, we've added a new program. We have a combined program with the University of Scranton. 5 years, MD, Masters of Health Administration. Applications are to start June 2011. The composition of the program is twofold. 4 years will be in the medical school itself, in between years two and three. The students will go over to the University of Scranton, take 52 credits, and do an internship in health administration, and then they'll come back and finish out their last 2 years. We have slots, I think, I know, for five. Okay. Now, this is my favorite. I do have to do two commercials. I want to again invite you, even though we haven't finished this meeting, to the next faculty development meeting. I think it's very important that everybody comes. I am also under orders to pitch one more thing. On Friday, October 15th, I was calling Dr. Cuck's office up today, and I didn't get through. But Ed Leahy, who's Leahy Clinic at Scranton, it's a free medical clinic. Invariably, we're going to be involved with it. The Medical Society is heavily involved with it, and they're going to have the last place I thought I'd find myself on a Friday night, but a wine tasting thing. It's $20. It's first class. Brennan Hall, if you haven't seen it, the fifth floor of Brennan is probably the nicest floor in Scranton right now. It's going to be magnificent. And if you can, please call the Medical Society. It's for the free clinic. It's a very, very good purpose. And also, you will get Ed Leahy and Dr. D'Alessandri off my back if you do that. So I'd appreciate it. Okay, now, I'm supposed to say 1,000 thanks. I can't say 1,000. It's 10,000. Folks, when you hear all the plans and everybody taking, maybe giving bows whether they deserve it or not, the real credit goes to you folks. And you've heard me say it before. I sincerely mean it. And I could barely not say it without my voice cracking. Without you guys and ladies, we have nothing. Now, last year, let me tell you your report card. The students assessed your efforts. Over 95% highest accolades. More importantly, you assessed the students. 100% highest rating you could give them. I don't know of anything in Scranton that was rated as 100%. And it wasn't a stuffed ballot box. So I'm just saying that for those of you who are helping, it's worth it, it's appreciated, and you've, in general, really liked it. The community mentors and clinical preceptors, I'm not going to go into any detail, but those are the ones who are going to help most in the three-week experience. The research project mentors, same thing. Admission screeners and interviewers. I mentioned this enormous workload. Trust me, it's unbelievable. And last year, 117 physicians' hours were put in, volunteer, from amongst your ranks. We really could use all the help we could get in the interview process. For those of you who have an hour or 2 hours to shoot on Friday, and I know that you don't have it, but make it, just call our admissions department and say you'd like to do it. I will guarantee you, you will consider it a rewarding experience. You will only interview students who have gone through the screening process. That doesn't make it easier to interview. That means their QPIs are all 3.5, and they're all top quarter of their class, basically. The first interview I did this year, U.S. Naval Academy graduate, a lawyer, top one percentile MCAT, and the GPA was off the wall. These are the kind of kids you're going to see. So it's fun. And clinical lectures and presentations. We are now going to start to fill in the second semester of the second year. We have the first semester well taken care of, thanks to many of you. And we're going to be soliciting by systems. What I'm talking about is renal, pulmonary, cardiology, and several other fields. And we're going to ask for folks if they would be willing to help and do demonstrations. Again, this has been greatly appreciated by everybody, and also I haven't had any negative feedback from anybody who's done it. So I will be asking you to do that, and we're also going to ask to see if we could get some iPods, which we'll explain another time. And now we're getting into last, and I know I'm going too long, and I apologize. Committee members, we will have committees, and I can't even tell you the amount of work that you folks do. All I could say is it's appreciated. Okay, so with that, I'm going to introduce my good friend, Dr. Jack Pryor, who's going to solve all health reform issues in 10 minutes. It's going to be great.
Thanks, Jack. I don't think it's very fair. Anyway, so I'm a nephrologist, so you're probably all wondering why I'm here. Jay Vanston knows very well why I'm here. His wife, Patty Vanston, got me in a time where I was kind of weak, and I said I would be interested to kind of go through this and go over it. And I'm glad that Jerry mentioned the Leahy Clinic. I don't know, for any of you that don't know what the Leahy Clinic is, the Leahy Clinic is a clinic that's run at the University of Scranton in the bottom of the nursing school there. It's a wonderful place. And I would say that that's where I start my talk of healthcare reform, because the people I see there are uninsured. And I think that what I thought was really impressive to me about who are the people that were uninsured and why is this new program coming out to take care of the uninsured. And I was floored by who it was. It was people that work 50 and 60 hours a week, have a family of four that make $10 an hour. It was people that were in our country for the first time. I mean, there was a lot of people that were all different. I see Paul's here, Paul does it with me, and I know that Greg does it with me as well. And Greg runs the whole thing, so it's a wonderful thing. So let's start with that, and we'll talk about what healthcare reform is going to be, and hopefully we'll talk about how it's going to change our practice. Oh, wrong way. We'll give the 1,000 thanks again, Jerry. All right. So the shortened version of this is called the Affordable Care Act, and we live in interesting times. And I was talking to Jerry, and I was talking to my father-in-law, and he was telling me when Medicare came out, how interesting that was, how people boycotted it, how it was the end of the world, how it was socialized medicine. And this was during the Johnson era. And here we are later down. Same things are being said about this as well. So let's talk about the problems with our current system. Many people are uninsured. I mean, it's clear to me. We'll talk about the exact number, but there's around 50 to 60 million people that are uninsured in our country. The costs and future costs of our healthcare system are much too high to be sustainable. And lastly, our healthcare outcomes aren't as good as we think they are. We rank in less than the top 10% in many of the things, despite the amount of money that we spend. So this is healthcare coverage in the United States, and you can see that we're mostly an employer-based coverage. So over 50% of these are employer-based sponsored insurance, and that's where we're starting with the model. The amount of uninsured is between 15 and 20% in our country. The Medicaid and other public insurance and Medicare, and then you can see the private group. So the majority of our healthcare coverage in the United States is employer-based, but there's a large percentage of people that are uninsured. So a couple facts about the uninsured. Number one, the number has risen to over 50 million people. That's a huge amount of people that are uninsured. Number two, most uninsured, so about 90%, are low and moderate income families. So these are people that a family of four, it's considered to be the magic number that they use is 133% poverty. That's $22,500. So a family of four living on $22,500 a year, up to about $88,500. So that's low and moderate income. So most of these people are poor, obviously. But there are a fair amount of people that are working, as I'll show you. 80% of them are U.S. citizens. So it's not the people that have come into the United States as immigrants. It's not the people that have come into the United States as people that come in illegally into the United States. These are our citizens. So 80% of these people are uninsured, are U.S. citizens. They come from working families. 77% of these people work. You know, and 61% of them have full-time jobs. The cost of an employee plan, the average cost of an employee plan now is about $14,000. Is it any surprise that you're starting with making $22,500 and can't afford an employee plan? Medicaid enrollment is up during this recession because a lot of people have lost their jobs, not surprisingly. And then finally, federal restrictions prevent us from allowing immigrants to be covered by our insurance for at least 5 years. So the whole statement about people that are, we're going to be insuring all these people that are immigrants or illegal immigrants is wrong. Despite the fact that that's a wrong statement, period, it's wrong. That's not what's going to happen. These are U.S. citizens. So if you look at the household income, you can see that the lower two on the left-hand side are 40, you know, the $25,000 is the poverty level. And then you go anywhere from poverty level to moderate, and moderate is four times poverty level. So about 90% of these people are low and moderate income. So second part is, what are the costs? So we all know that healthcare is about 17% of our GDP. That's higher than any other nation in the world. annually, we've had a 6.6% rise in our healthcare expenditures. That's estimated that in 2075, we're going to be up to 38% of our GDP. There's no way we can sustain that. Employer-based insurance has risen to almost $14,000 a year, and the contribution that the employees are making has risen to $4,000 a year by the employee. So you can see that these numbers, to me, are staggering. These are unbelievably high numbers that are very hard for us to sustain and hard for us to afford. And private insurance have, and the last thing, the private insurance profits, so private insurers that are public companies, that are publicly traded companies, that are for-profit countries, their profits have increased by 250% in the last 10 years, 10 times inflation. So there's something wrong with that equation. So the expenditures by people, employers, and et cetera, are skyrocketing, and the profits are skyrocketing too. So there's a problem with that, and so hence why healthcare reform has come. So you can see on the left-hand side, this is what insurance premiums have done over the past 10 years, and this is what salaries have done. You can see that there's 108% increase in insurance premiums over the past 10 years, and on the bottom side, that's what the number one, that's the consumer price index and the wage index. So you can see wages have gone up a little bit, but nowhere near as much as the expenditures for healthcare. And the actual contribution to this, so you can see that in this is from 5 years, so you've gone from 10,880 to 13,770, and the contribution of the individual employees they're making now towards their insurance is much higher. So it's the companies, it's higher for the companies, it's higher for the employees. Percentage-wise, it's higher for the employees than ever. And then finally, that's really just, I'm sorry about this, but this is just a repeat, just to reemphasize the point that if you look at inflation and wages on the bottom part, you'll see that that nowhere near matches what the insurance premiums have gone up with. So in some ways, it's not surprising that the profits of some of the private insurers have gone up by 250%. So I want to show you a couple of outcome studies. I want to show you a little bit about how much money we spend and how we do. And there's a couple organizations that I'm going to use as a resource. One is this Organization of Cooperation and Development. And their mission is to bring together governments of various countries committed to democracy and the market economy, which is, you know, basically capitalist societies. So these are the countries that are involved in this organization. You can see that they're the usual hitters. There's Canada, there's Belgium, there's Chile, there's the Czech Republic, Germany and Greece, Ireland, Japan. So most of Europe, some of Asia, some of South America, and the United States is part of this organization as well. And if you look at healthcare expenditure, and if you look at the middle there, the middle is the average healthcare expenditure per nation. That's the OECD net, the average. Way on the left-hand side is the U.S. The U.S. spends almost 2.5 times the average. Now, we're not alone. I mean, there's other countries that spend a fair amount, like France and Germany and the Netherlands spend a fair amount. But none of them are more, all of them are less than half of what we spend per year. So that would be great if we had the best healthcare system in the world and we had the best outcomes. But unfortunately, this is a graph that looks at how much we spend in life expectancy. So I could show you a bunch of different statistics, whether they be infant mortality, death after diagnosis of diabetes, death after diagnosis of heart disease, death after reaching age 65. I could show mortality for maternity. I could show you all these things. They all would look the same. They all look the same. And life expectancy to me is the accumulation of all of them. If you look at this, this is looking at life expectancy versus how much you spend. And all the way on the right-hand side is the U.S., where we spend a lot of money, but our life expectancy is nowhere near some of the other nations that are there. And I guess the question I want to raise is why? Why is it not this? So despite spending the most money per capita and percentage GDP, our outcomes are, for many basic outcomes, aren't even in the first 10%. Yes, we're very good for certain types of things. We're very good for salvage therapy, for cancer, for certain types of cancer. We're good for coronary disease. There's a lot of things that we're excellent at. But the accumulation of all these things in our society lead to a lower life expectancy than everybody else. So we obviously don't do the basics right. Is this due to poor quality? Is this because we have ineffective treatments? Is this because we have sicker patients? Or is this the fact that there's a good percentage of people that are uninsured? And I make the case that a large part of this is the fact that a large percentage of our population is uninsured. The uninsured always do worse in any study you've ever looked at for outcomes. So I think that at least part of it is access to care because of uninsured. I just saw a guy today in the hospital with a creatinine of 15, and I hadn't seen him for 2 years. And I said, why haven't I seen you for 2 years? I lost my insurance. So he decided to, so we treat people that are uninsured with crisis intervention. And that's not a very effective way of managing people. So this is the World Health Statistics. So this is not just this organization that has shown the same thing. There's various worldwide organizations that have looked at healthcare expenditure versus life expectancy and versus other outcomes. And this is the World Healthcare. Again, all the way to the right is the United States, that dot there. And if you look at this, is again life expectancy versus money spent. And if you look at ours, we fall off the graph each time. So, and why do people put off care? There's a lot of different reasons they put off care. They've done, and a lot of different solutions that people have gone. They might use home remedies. They postpone getting health care. I have people that don't take, that will take half their medicine or none of their medicine, depending on what medicines they are. You know, I've learned the formulary of Walmart to a science, because you can get medicines for $4 and $10 for 3 months. You know, so, I mean, there's a lot of reasons why people don't have access to, why people don't, if you don't have insurance in general, people won't go for access to care. So this is talking about solutions. And the solution was, we don't want the government involved here. And the cartoon says, no government health care. And the person says, nice scooter chair. Well, thanks, Medicare got it for me. And like my father-in-law told me about Medicare was going to be the end of all mankind. I mean, it was socialized medicine. It was government being involved in our health care. Well, Medicare didn't seem to be such a bad thing. If you look at satisfaction of people that are covered by insurance plans, Medicare and the VA system are probably the two highest in satisfaction that there are in our nation. So despite the fact that we all have our gripes about Medicare, and despite the fact that patients have their gripes about Medicare, they tend to do better than most everything, and that's a government-run system. So what are the attributes of an ideal health system? It would expand coverage to include the whole, regardless of economic or health status. It would improve quality and outcomes and keep people healthier, and will make healthcare affordable to the individual businesses in our nation. So I think that that's what the plan for the Affordable Care Act is all about, these three goals. So if you look at this, and you look at the OECD people, and I told you that they're pretty heavy hitters. They're the usual people, usual countries that you would say are industrialized, that have good economies, et cetera. All these are at the bottom. And there are only three countries that don't have universal or near universal health care of these member nations. That's Turkey and Mexico and the United States. Every other nation has universal or near universal health care coverage in various different ways. They're not all state-run systems. Some of them are private insurers, some are not. But what they have is they have a mandate that everybody's going to be covered in the country. So, and some of them are publicly funded, some of them are privately funded, some are financed by taxes, et cetera. We're the only three nations in the world in that organization that don't have universal or near universal coverage. So I would make the case that that's one of the reasons why our outcomes aren't as good. That's why we don't live as long. That's why we have a high infant mortality rate. That's why we have problems with OB and delivery and things like that. That's why we have public health problems, is because the fact that many of our patients are not covered. So a summary of I'm going to give you the 2 minute, this is the 10 minutes that Jerry gave me to give you a summary of what the whole thing is going to be about. So what's going to happen with this new plan, if it works out, is that it's going to expand coverage to now 94% of patients. That's a good thing. I mean, how could that be a bad thing? It's going to regulate insurance company behaviors, which means that you're not going to be able to drop somebody. They're not going to be able to drop somebody because of pre-existing, well, not because of pre-existing. You can get insurance if you have a pre-existing condition. They can't drop you if you get sick. There's not going to be lifetime limits on spending for coverage, et cetera. So those are so they're going to regulate what insurers do. They're going to make healthcare actually decrease the deficit because we said that we can't afford what we're doing right now. So I'll show you a few of the numbers about what the estimates of what's going to happen to healthcare in general over the next 10 years once this plan goes into place. If you look at how they do this, you're going to have a much greater increase in coverage than you do in spending. So they estimate that you're going to have that you'll actually decrease the deficit by 2020 if you do this. So our spending is actually good, we'll be much more efficient about how we spend it, but we'll increase our coverage to the 94% range. And we hope we're going to improve patient outcomes with a relatively flexible preemptive program of proven therapies. Flexible is that they have a lot of flexibility built into this. There's not one way to solve the problem. They're going to try a bunch of different things, and whatever works, they're going to go with it. So I have to say that there's not one thing that's etched in stone about this, about how we're going to do this. So the expanded coverage. So there's going to have coverage for all that have a salary less than 133% of poverty. So that's a family of four, $22,500. So everybody's going to be covered in that thing. So there'll be subsidies for families of four that make less than $88,000. So that's another one. So the subsidies it depends on your salary. If you make $23,000, you're going to get pretty well subsidized. If you make $88,000, you won't get as much subsidy. They'll be able to get insurance from pools. They're going to have statewide insurance pools where they'll be able to pick pools from these, and they'll be able to select the coverage that they want. They'll be able to select the doctors that they want. There's not going to be a limit to those things. This is all about patient care more than anything else. A company of 50 employees must provide insurance, so that's one of the things. So if you're an employee of 50 or more, that employer has to pay it, or they're going to provide insurance. Now, they'll be subsidized, they'll get tax breaks, but they have to provide it. If they don't provide it, then they get fined for it. So expanded coverage that's already gone into effect is if you have a dependent that's going to school or whatever, they're going to cover dependents up to age 26 now. So if your student is, if you have a student in college or you have a student in graduate school and they're still dependent on you, they'll be automatically covered by your coverage. That expands, I mean, that's one of the large populations of people who are uncovered are people that are the young adults. They'll have health insurance exchanges in high-risk pools. Each state will have these pools where you'll be able to, the high-risk pool will be national, where you'll be able to, because of the number of people in the pool, it'll be relatively inexpensive for people to get coverage. The health insurance exchanges are going to be regulated by the states, and you'll have various people that'll offer health care, and you'll have easy ways to pick which plan you'd rather based on the amount that you'll spend and the amount that the coverage that you'll get. You're going to have protection from being dropped or denied. So if you develop diabetes, they can't drop you from their coverage. If you have a pre-existing condition, they can't say, well, no, we're not going to cover you. And there's going to be no lifetime limits. So how are they going to make it affordable? They're going to make it affordable by, first, I'm going to show you some of the ways they're going to make money to do this. First, they're going to have an independent payment advisory board. And this is, from a physician standpoint, this is going to be the tough one, I think. This board is going to be 15 independent people that are not partisan, plus three people from the Department of Health and Human Services, who are going to assess the rise in healthcare prices for the year. If it's above a certain amount and they have a complex formula for how it's going to be, then this committee is charged with decreasing, making cuts and making things that will change how we do it. This committee is not allowed to decrease coverage, but it certainly is allowed to change how we do it. So maybe they won't pay as much for a chest x-ray, or maybe, you know, or maybe they'll have some influence. Actually, this committee is not allowed to touch hospitals, but it's allowed to cut physicians and services and things like that. So this is going to be the mandate. Now, they have so this committee, the changes become law unless Congress comes up with something that will save money equally as well. So this committee is charged with sort of putting the reins on healthcare costs. They're going to have premium reviews. So if a independent insurer wants to raise their premiums, they have to go through a state board, and if the state board doesn't approve it, if there's not a reasonable thing to do, then they'll say no. There'll be greater than 10% increase in people covered for less than 2% increase in spending. So that's actually not a bad deal if you look at it. It's going to be more cost-effective care for people that are Medicare that have Part D. They're going to close the donut hole. That's already starting. They're getting reimbursements this year. They're going to regulate the insurer medical. So what they'll say is that the insurer is not allowed to take in premiums more. They're 80% of the premiums that are taken in have to be spent in medical expenditure, not in administration, not in disbursement to public options, not in disbursement to stockholders. So the 80% number is for people that have small plans. The 85% number is for people that have plans that are greater than 50. So they're going to regulate the insurers. Now, I would tell you that in most other countries, they regulate the insurers and they're not allowed to be for profit. If they're not for profit, then they don't spend, then they don't disperse money to stockholders. If they're not for profit, the administration costs come way down. So I don't know if that's going to be the next thing to do, but for right now, they're going to limit how much, they're going to say, if you take in this much premium, you have to spend 80% of it on medical expenditure. And right now, they're fighting about what medical expenditure means. So if you look at administrative costs throughout the world, the left-hand side, as usual in this talk, is going to be the U.S., and the left-hand side in this is we spend, compared to the other country, twice as much or three times as much as administrative costs. So that's part of the reason why our healthcare is so expensive, is it costs, the administrative cost is so expensive. And so talking about how they're going to finance this, if you go from top to bottom, if you look at the impact on the deficit, they think there's going to be a negative $143 million, despite the fact that we're going to cover 50 million people more. So how are they going to do that? They're going to do that by a few different things. One is they're going to have an excise tax on high premium, so they're going to have this thing called the Cadillac tax, starting in about 2018 or 2020. If you have way above basic need type of insurance, then you're going to have to pay a premium on doing that. So that's going to make some money. Second thing is they're going to have a surtax on the wealthy. So how's that going to occur? If you make more than $250,000, they're going to increase your Medicare tax. Secondly, if you make more than $250,000, they'll be able to tax passive income. So that's another place where they're going to make money from it. The other things that they're going to be able to do is they're going to decrease, if you ever saw those Medicare Alliance plans for the elderly, they spend an inordinate amount of money to those insurers to do that. They're going to ramp those back completely because they find that those things, that's one of the reasons for the 250% increase in profits of these insurers. So they're going to ramp them back. They're going to probably ramp back some of the hospital payments because some of the hospitals get reimbursed for, they're given money because they figure they're going to take care of the uninsured. Now that their patients aren't going to be uninsured, they won't need to give them that money anymore. So that's another place that they're doing. And then hopefully system improvements and savings, which is a big thing. Now, I will tell you that two independent organizations have analyzed this. One is the Congressional Budget Office, and the second are actuaries from the CMS. And both of them have come up with the fact that, you know, they differ a little bit in their figures, but at the end of it, they say by 2020, they think that they're going to actually have this revenue neutral, or they'll have it revenue positive into the United States and be able to decrease the deficit. So our rate of rise or growth is going to markedly diminish, hopefully by 2020. So there's been a couple different independent organizations. And that's just to show the difference in the rate, that the lower rate is what we're going to do. So, and I don't really want to, but so how good are these people? Well, they've done this a couple times. One, they did it for Medicare Hospital, the PPS program, and this Congressional Budget Office said we're going to have $10 billion savings. Turned out that it was actually $21 billion savings. Second time, they looked at skilled nursing facility, home health, and fraud waste, and they said there's going to be $112 billion savings, and actually they found it was actually 50% bigger than what they thought it was going to be. So they tend to be pretty conservative. The point of this is that the CBO tends to be pretty conservative. So it may take a long time to reduce, but maybe, I'm not sure, but it'll add some weight initially. So I think initially the expenditure is going to increase, but what their goal is to actually decrease the expenditure by 2020. So improved quality and outcomes, how are they going to do that? Well, number one, I think it's really important. The first statement is the most important: insured do better than uninsured. I just think I can't emphasize that enough. And every time you've ever looked at this, the insured do better than uninsured. And it's not just socioeconomic. It has to do with access to care. So I, you know, we've taken care of a lot of people that have no insurance and they come in crisis. And I just think that that's not a way to take care of people. I mean, I've had people that come to me that have a creatinine of 15 and need to start dialysis and they have no insurance. What do? I have to send them through the emergency room as an emergency admission. They have to be hospitalized. They have to get an emergency procedure. They have the expenditure for this one. I could just send it to an outpatient to a surgeon who could do the procedure as an outpatient and start dialysis as an outpatient. It'd be a lot cheaper to do it that way if they were insured. So, prevention, yearly exam. So they're going to really emphasize prevention in this. They're going to make sure that everybody gets a yearly exam that's paid for, especially Medicare recipients. All the screenings that we all agree on are good are going to be done. They're going to be paid for. There's going to be no cost to the patient. Even things like counseling for obesity, counseling for tobacco, even things like nicotine replacement therapy are going to be paid for by this thing. So prevention is a big part of this whole thing. They're going to bolster primary care in not the best way that I can think of, because the problem is that, yes, they're going into increased coverage, but I have to say that they're, and that'll be part of our GME thing, is that they don't have as good a sense of how they're going to increase the ranks of caregivers. I mean, I think that that's something that's incomplete. You know, I think that we're going to have what they found in Boston in Massachusetts, when you covered everybody, it was great and people did better, but the problem is that they had problems having access to care because there wasn't enough primary caregivers. So I think that that's a big problem that needs to be solved. So how are they going to, so you all remember the USPDDF, they're actually a wonderful organization that's a nonpartisan organization that's employed by the government that reviews articles, reviews studies, and comes out with guideline recommendations as far as screening, et cetera. They're going to be they'll be the soothsayers for this whole thing. So if they say it's appropriate to screen for this, then things will be paid for, and that's how it's going to work. And they're going to continue that. We have to continue to do quality indicator reporting. And finally, I think an interesting thing, and I think that this is going to be something that'll be interesting in the future, they're going to have Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute. And that's going to be separately funded. And that's going to do studies, like it'll do a study that'll look at renal vascular hypertension and do angioplasty on people that have renal artery stenosis and come up with the answer about whether it's appropriate to do or not appropriate to do. I just think that that's the way to do it, instead of having this hodgepodge of things and being left with poor studies that never answer the question. So because you have poor studies and never answer the question, you end up still paying for the procedure if it doesn't work. So I think that this is an exciting part of this. So in I'm a healthcare enforcement officer, ma'am. Put down the snack cake and take two steps back. So obesity and prevention are going to be a big part of this whole thing. So, all right. So in the last 5 minutes, I'm going to talk about the impact on physicians, and I'm going to talk about hopefully GME a little quick, so we're going to fly through this a little bit. So I think what's going to happen, and this is just sort of what I could glean from what I read. So I by no means am a healthcare expert. I'm a nephrologist. As a nephrologist, we work a lot. We now take care of dialysis patients. Our dialysis care is bundled. So the care of dialysis patient is bundled. They give you a price. This is for you to take care of the patient. They've also done incentives for us. So they've said, we think that it's important that you see these patients on a weekly basis. So instead of what they used to pay as a monthly fee, they pay us, if we go and see people one time, we get paid a certain fee. If we see them two or three times, we get another fee. If we see them four times, which they think is the right way to do it, they pay us more. And I think that that's going to be the model that we're going to see. We're going to see bundled care, and we're going to see incentivized care. And the incentivized care is going to be reflected in what they consider good health care. They're going to decide this is the appropriate way to care for patients. So what's going to happen? So they're going to have more patients with insurance. They're going to start to pay us to use EHR, at least to start with electronic health records. Primary care is going to have increased Medicaid and Medicare reimbursement for 2 to 5 years. So primary care, they're going to ramp up how much a general internist, a pediatrician, a family practitioner is going to make from Medicare for a period of 5 years. From Medicaid, they're going to increase that to Medicare levels for 2 years. They're also going to increase levels to surgeons in certain physician hardship areas. They're going to increase the levels to Medicare levels as well. So their trial is to say we have some deficiencies, we're going to try to make it more attractive to be a primary caregiver. We know that that's a tough job, we should pay you more for that. And that's what they're going to do. there, if you own a, if I don't own Mercy Hospital, I that wasn't one of the buyers as far as I know. So if I did own Mercy Hospital, I wouldn't be able to send my patients to Mercy Hospital. So that's going to be a regulation. So if I own a hospital, I can't send my patients there. They're going to have an increase. So a lot of us make a good salary. We're going to be paying more taxes. I mean, it's the simple thing. If you go out of the United States, you'll find out that, like Ireland or things like that, you'll find out that people pay a lot more taxes than we do. We make more money, we're going to be paying more taxes. There's no two ways about it. But however, in our practices, we give health care to our employees. It's going to be probably cheaper for us to do this. There'll be more choices for us to do. And our insurance claims are going to be standardized. You're not going to have 20 different insurance claims. You're not going to have 20 different regulations. You're going to have one system to do this. And you're going to have more preventative services for your patients. And you're going to have the Independent Payment Advisory Board, which is Big Brother, that's going to be sort of over our head. And I think that that's going to be the thing that I'm not sure what's going to happen with that. I don't think anybody is sure what's going to happen to physicians with this. They're going to have multiple trial programs. Like I said, this is going to be a flexible thing. They want to try different things and see what they work. They're going to have accountable care organizations. So they'll say to you, we want you to manage these diabetics, and whatever money you save, you make. So we want you to find the best way to take care of them, and we want to find the most cost-efficient way. And if you save money on their care because you do a good job of caring, and good care oftentimes is cheaper than bad care, then they're going to pay, they'll share those profits with you. They're going to have bundled care, so certain diagnoses will have bundled care. So if you come in with coronary disease and you need bypass surgery, they're going to pay the hospital and the physician this much money to take care of that, and that's what it's going to be. They said they're going to have some trial programs for malpractice reform, and the medical home is going to be part of this whole situation because they think that that's a more efficient, team-based approach to taking care of patients. And again, I'm really excited about the comparative effectiveness research. There's a couple other things, like I think when they've looked at this program, the AMA, et cetera, the AMA has said, good, we're fine with it. A few of the other organizations have said, good, we're fine with it. Some of the specialist organizations have not been happy, and the reason they're not happy is because there's no fix for the SGR. So we know that every year we go through this thing where the SGR has to decide what it's going to pay us, and it's really supposed to pay us 21% less because of the Balanced Budget Act of 1997. And they've staved it off every year for us. Well, they haven't come up with a solution for that yet. So I think a lot of people, physicians would feel a little bit better if we had a solution for that. And Dan Berwick is going to be the head of CMS, or he is the head of CMS. So you kind of, I don't know if you guys know who Dan Berwick is. Dan Berwick's a really interesting guy with the Institute of Medicine. And Don Berwick, I'm sorry, Don Berwick. Yeah, that's what it is. Me and, we don't correspond that, yeah. But I think he's a really interesting guy. He looks at things that are outcomes-based research, and I think that that's going to be an interesting place to go. And finally, just a quick one on GME. The only real changes that they make, and I wish they made more changes, but the only changes they made is that unused residency spots will now be able to, based on the need and based on the state, will be slotted into primary care. So they'll take, you know, a pediatric, well, not pediatrics is a primary care, but they'll take a neurology residency, and if it's not, the slot's not filled, they'll be able to move that to another place. Because they really don't want to increase the number of residents that they're paying for right now. They also are going to look at they're going to look specifically at indirect care. I mean, if you look at how hospitals are reimbursed for having residents, they have direct and indirect costs. Direct costs are pretty easy. That's how much it costs you to pay a resident. That's pay the salary, the health care insurance, pay all those things. Indirect costs are the costs that the Medicare says that it costs you more money to take care of patients in a teaching hospital. Indirect costs are twice what direct costs are. And most people, independent advisories have felt that this is real, and this has been consistent year after year after year, felt that this is an overpay. So what they're talking about doing is they want to take some of this and they want to incentivize care. By incentivized training, they want to make sure that, okay, we'll pay for your residents to train, but we want to make sure that you do a good job training them. And what they've adopted is they've adopted the core competencies as their outcomes. So anybody that looks at CME now or medical school or residency training, they look at the core competencies as how, what our outcomes should be. And the core competencies are things like medical knowledge, professionalism, systems-based practice, practice-based learning. So there's a bunch of, there's a little bit different things. And I don't know how they're going to measure that myself. So, but I think that there is a big problem, and this is, I'll leave it with this. The big problem is that this is the match from 2010, and this is the number of people that matched for various programs, and this is at the end of the day how many matched and are going to do primary care, and you'll see that the number of people that are going to do primary care are 16 to 18%. So I think primary care is a huge problem, and I don't think that this was addressed by healthcare reform. So I'll leave it at that. I'm sorry for running over, and it's a pretty complex thing, but I have to say that I was impressed in reading the outcomes. If you're really interested in reading more about this, the New England Journal over the past year has done a wonderful job, and anytime you look at a guy that talks, John Englehart, Englehart is a wonderful, he just does a great job of writing, and he explains things that even a nephrologist could understand. So I have to say that I would really recommend those things if you're interested in further reading about this. And without further ado, I'm going to introduce Val. And Valerie is our head of medicine here, and she's wonderful. And I took put her time, and I'm sorry about that.
No. So thank you very much, Jack. I have to say that that was very well done, very informative, and to explain something that complex. Which anything involving the government's going to be. That was remarkable. So thank you for doing that for us. We're going to shift gears. As you know, I've been heavily involved in planning for the third year. So our very first charter class will be starting their third year, June 27th, 2011, which I was just counting on my fingers, is about 8.5 months away. So planning has been underway for some time now. We're very excited. As you know from previous meetings, our third year class is going to be doing a very remarkable and innovative model for their education. Instead of doing rotations through hospital settings month by month by month, medicine, surgery, they're going to be spending their whole year mostly in ambulatory settings following panels of patients in all the core disciplines. We've been contacting lots of you and soliciting lots of you to sponsor third year medical students coming up in June. How many people here have agreed to do that so far? Quite a few. Wow. Quite a few hands going up. Thank you. If you haven't been contacted by some stretch of the imagination or want to or have been thinking about it or being on the fence, please contact me and I'll sell you on it. But it's been a remarkable outpouring of people wanting to do this. So tonight we're going to talk about what will you be doing with the students in your office. This is all part of us getting ready for June 27th, 2011. And I hope that you leave tonight understanding that you can do this. That you have the skills to do this. And this is going to be just some tips and tricks. We have a lot of little video clips of different doctors demonstrating some things to make your life go smoothly with having students in your office because you're very busy and you're trying to see patients and teach at the same time. So how do you do it? That's what we're going to be talking about. So community teaching, this is what our third year is going to be about. It's really returning to the historical roots of medicine, getting students where the patients are, in ambulatory settings mostly, providing for this real world education. They're going to be seeing what you do every day. You'll be the role models for our students. And this is really our core philosophy of how we're going to do our clinical education at TCMC, and this is going to make us quite different from the traditional medical school model. So we're going to be teaching the students as we practice. We're not going to be giving mini lectures. We're not going to be preparing PowerPoint slides. That's not what we're going to be doing. We're going to be doing real world teaching moments. And it's just based on what you're doing every day. And I like to think of it this way. The real teachers are not us, the faculty. The real teachers are the patients. And what we're doing as faculty is allowing the patients and the students to get close together while keeping everybody safe. So we're sort of, we have our arms around the dyad of the patient and the student, allowing the patient to teach the student medicine in a setting where the patient will be safe and the learner will be safe. And that's how I like to think about this, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. So what will you be doing as a third year preceptor? Well, obviously, you already learned, those of you who had first year or second year students in your office, you know how to introduce them into the office setting and how to provide a little bit of orientation and how to get your office staff involved in that. You know, how to assess how the student's doing and give them feedback, and we're going to talk all about that tonight. So how to start off? Let's imagine it's July of 2011 and you're just getting started with your new third year TCMC student. Those of you who had them know that they're going to be very well prepared. But you'll probably want to sit down with them at first and see where they're at, talk about what their experiences so far have been, either in your office or elsewhere. Reviewing the goals. We have goals and objectives for all the clerkships we'll be doing in the third year, so they'll have that, and you'll be able to review that with them. And you'll explain how your office schedule works and how you want them to interact with patients. And you'll talk to them a little bit about exam room flow. What I always did in my practice, and I've done this for years, I wish I could have had a talk like this because I just feel, you know, figured it out by trial and error. But what I also always did is just kept my schedule the same. I was an internist, I had a pretty sick population, elderly population, and so I had visits every 20 minutes. And what I do is my office staff were pretty good about having the patients teed up. So usually by the time I started, there were two patients teed up. My student would go in and see the first patient. I'd go in and see the next patient. And by the time I was done with my second patient, they were about done with my first, because, you know, it takes the student longer. And then I would go back and see the first patient. And then by the time we were done with that, there were a couple more patients. So it kind of does work out without much schedule adjustment. It's always a really good idea to introduce the patient. Some people want to use a handout for this to let everyone in your office know, all of your patients know that you're going to have a student there. So you could just provide these and have them in the waiting room. We have a template for this, and when we get closer to June, we'll give this to you if you want to use it. Some people think it's better to do this without the student right in front of you because it has, you know, gives the patient an opportunity to say no. I knew my patients pretty well, and I usually did it with the student there. I guess that was some subtle pressure, maybe. And you know your patients pretty well, and you know which of them may object, but most patients are quite generous with this. So we're gonna have our first video clip, I think, here, and we have a wonderful second year medical student as the actress in some of these clips, and then you have me. I'm not a good actress, but.
Good morning, it's great to see you again, Mrs. Jones. I want to introduce you to a TCMC medical student, Kristen Sushniak.
Hi, Kristen.
She's going to be with me for the entire year. She's going to be here every Monday afternoon, and she's an integral part of the team here. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to introduce you. What she's going to do is she's going to get started. She's going to talk to you and do a bit of an exam. And I'll be out seeing another patient, and then I'll come back in and we'll do our usual. Does that sound okay?
Fine.
And that's usually what I would do in practice. And, you know, I generally found that I only had to do that first time with any patient. Because what these students are going to be doing in their third year, it's going to be much more active than the shadowing they've been doing in the first and second year. They're actually going to get to know a panel of your patients. So they will be able to meet the patient, and then once they know the patient, they may not need to be reintroduced every time, right? So again, you probably don't have to modify your schedule. You do want to pick out appropriate cases. You want to have the student get a mix. Some days you might want them to see some very common and uncomplicated things, especially at the beginning of the year, a sore throat, an earache. And then as they get more able to pick up those complicated patients, like the congestive heart failure patient with osteoporosis and chest pain and five other things going on. You know, you generally do want to prime the student, and what that is, we're going to show a video in a minute, but it gives the student a little bit of a warm-up of what to go in there and do. I used to joke that, you know, if you're not out in 10 minutes, I'm going to send in the National Guard for you. Sometimes the students will get very lost in the room and go on a very long fishing expedition for a complete H&P, and by the time they're in their third year, we really want them to start to really focus. So again, prime the student, allow them to go see the patient, you go see the next one, and then tell them somewhere to meet you so that they're not lost in your office. It's like meet in the conference room or meet back in my office. So these are just two ways you can prime the student. And we're going to show a video clip of this, but Mrs. Jones is a healthy 28-year-old lady. She's here for a yearly examination. at her age, what are the most important screening things we need to address? So you're doing a little teaching moment, and you're also giving them a focus of what to do when they get in the room, rather than just going every place. So let's watch a priming video here.
Okay, Kristen, I've looked at my schedule this morning, and I have several interesting patients that we're going to have you pick up. The first one, Mrs. Jones, she's 50 years old. She has a history of osteoporosis and congestive heart failure. She called in the office yesterday, and we got her in for an appointment today because she's noticed some shortness of breath over the past couple of days. So I'm going to have you go in and talk to her. What symptoms do you want to ask her about, or what questions do you want to ask her about today?
Well, she has shortness of breath, and I know that she has a history of congestive heart failure, so I'm wondering if this is possibly from the CHF or if it could be some other cause. I'm going to ask her when her trouble breathing started. I'm also going to ask her if she has any other symptoms like fever or cough. And then finally, I'll ask if she's had any changes in her diet and if she's been taking her medications.
Okay, that sounds like a really good start. What parts of the physical exam would you want to focus on today?
The lower extremities, but also checking the JVD and the heart and lung exam to look for signs of congestive heart failure.
Okay, great. I'm going to let you go in and get started.
So you can see that this student is a woman with a mission now. She's not just going in to see Mrs. Jones and not even sure what she's going to do in the room with Mrs. Jones. She has a pretty good idea of what she's going to go in there and do in the next 15 minutes, and it's very focused around that patient's problems. And, you know, they're not going to be able to do this probably right off the bat, but this is the point to which we want them to get to. Framing is a similar technique. It's really, again, setting these parameters for the visit. So, you know, focusing the student so they're not in there for 40 minutes while you're trying to keep your busy office schedule going up. And we also have a little video on this. And I think this is one of the last ones with me in it, because this is very painful for me to watch this.
Okay, so I'm going to have you go in and see Mrs. Jones. I want you to focus on those questions and those parts of the physical exam we talked about. Don't spend more than 15 minutes, about 15, 20 minutes. Come meet me in my office. I'm going to go see another patient while you're doing that. And then we'll discuss Mrs. Jones and what we should do with her today.
Okay.
Okay, so again, just, you know, she's a woman with a mission. You've given her something to focus on. And she's going to go in there and hopefully gather the pertinent information. You're going to hook up with her and see how she's done, give her a lot of feedback on that. So we're going to go through some other techniques that you'll want to try. This is something that's called 1 minute observation. And by the way, everything, if you're really interested in this topic, first of all, these are all going to be on the portal. And we're making a video of this. You can go back and watch this at any time closer to June. The other thing is there's a great book called Teaching in Your Office, and everything I'm saying tonight is from there. It's put out by the ACP, and you can order it online. I think it's about $20, $22. So 1 minute observation is basically just a technique you can use to sort of see how your student's doing. And basically, you pick one thing that you're going to observe. You go in there for a minute. You basically tell the patient, I'm going to be in here for a minute, then I'm going to leave. The student's going to finish up with you, and then at the end, you provide some feedback to the student on how they did. Just one little thing to focus on.
For this first one, I just want to observe you at the beginning. I want to make sure that you ask a lot of open-ended questions, okay? All right? Okay. I'll just wait till you get started, and then I'll take off.
Okay.
Hi, Mrs. Beck.
Hi.
Hi, this is Alda. She's a medical student working with me this month. I'm just going to watch her get started with you, if that's okay, and then once she gets rolling, I'll take off, and I'll come back, and we'll sort things out later, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Hi, Mrs. Beck. I'm Alda Gonzaga. It's really nice to meet you.
Hi.
So can you tell me a little bit about what brought you in today?
I've been having really bad headaches for 20 years.
Can you tell me a little bit more about that? And can you tell me a little bit about the time of day that you feel these headaches?
Yeah, so much for the brief history. You're hoping that's not your first patient tomorrow morning, are you? Yeah, so a good teaching point there, that might not want to be the first. If you want the student to become an internist like you, you may not want to give them that as their first patient. So some teachers that are really skilled clinical teachers really like to have the student present in front of the patient. I've done this at times. Other times I haven't. I'm not sure always if I'm comfortable with it. But a lot of people who are very good at this think it's it's great, that it's the best way for the patient, it's the best way for the student. The patient can actually give feedback or correct some of the things the students are saying. So that's something that you may want to try and see how it works for you. The one thing that we don't want, though, is to have passive observation. I can't say that enough. You know, this is no longer shadowing like they've done in the first year. So if there is a period of time when you're really busy and the student maybe is not has already picked up a couple of patients that day and they're not going to pick up more and they're going to be with you, or they've already presented a patient with you and now you're going in to do the wrap-up, writing prescriptions and things, they can do things to help you. These students are great. They can be looking up dosages and side effects for you. They can be reviewing trends in blood pressure, looking up what the A1C was. They can be getting the vital signs for you while you write prescriptions or write the note. There's another technique that they call active observation, and that's basically really you think that this patient's just too complex for the student. Maybe this lady with 20 years of headaches would have been a good one for this. And what that is you're saying, look, this patient is not somebody I want you to go see on your own. She's positive for your systems. You'll be in there for 40 minutes. Let's go see her together. I'm very good at handling X, Y, and Z with this patient. I want to role model for you how I'm going to handle this particular type of issue. Or, you know, I'm about to go in and break some bad news to this patient. I want you to watch how I do it. So that's not shadowing, that's active observation. You're priming the student, telling them ahead of time what you want them to learn. And then afterwards, you'll debrief them.
Okay, Alda, this next one is a particularly interesting patient. She has a history of coronary artery disease, congestive heart failure, diabetes, and hypertension. She had an MI about 5 years ago, and now she has an ejection fraction of about 20%. I really like her. She's interesting. The trouble is that whenever I put a medical student in with her, she sort of keeps him in the room talking to him for like an hour. So I'm going to go in with you, and what I want you to watch is how I try to redirect her and keep her to task, yet at the same time show interest in her issues and let her know that I care about her medical problems, okay?
Okay.
All right.
So that was a way of, hopefully that student will learn some very good skills that that student can learn about, you know, things, handling a difficult patient or handling a difficult interaction. Again, sometimes you might want to try presenting in the room. It does save time. Studies have shown patients accept it, even though some of us feel uncomfortable. Hallways aren't very confidential if you're worried about HIPAA. Learners will tend to ramble less and be more concise when presenting. And it actually does increase your own face time with the patient as well. So you might want to try that. So there's things you might want to save for later, though, particularly talking about the pathophysiology of disease, talking about differentials that could include, you know, things like cancer or other alarming things. But you could do actually most of the presentation right in front of the patient. It's something to try. And here's an example of a successful delivery of this method.
A little bit behind. So next person, I'd like you to go in and then present to me in the room, okay? I'll just go ahead and get you started.
Okay.
Right? Hi, Mrs. Ritchie.
Hi.
This is Alda. She's a medical student working with me. What we're going to do, if that's okay with you, is she's going to talk to you for a little bit, and I'm going to leave. I'll come back, and then she'll fill me in about your medical problems when I get back. Okay?
Okay, sure.
All right. I'll see you.
Like Dr. Ronlicky said, I'm Alda Gonzaga. It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Can you tell me a little bit about what brought you in today?
Hi. Okay, Alda, do you want to fill me in about what's going on with Mrs. Ritchie?
So Mrs. Ritchie is a 30-year-old woman who was in her usual state of health until about 6 months ago when she started feeling some burning in her chest. It initially started about once a week, and now it's progressed to the point where she's feeling it once a day. It sometimes is associated with a bad taste in her mouth, and it's always occurring in the same place in her chest. She says that antacids actually help the pain go away, and things that make it worse are eating onions. She doesn't have any significant past medical history. She doesn't have any allergies to any medicines. She told me that she smokes about a pack a day of cigarettes, and she's thinking about cutting down.
Yeah.
On her exam, she was in no apparent distress. Her exam was pretty much unremarkable other than for some epigastric tenderness. And she didn't have any rebound or guarding on her abdominal exam.
Okay. That's very good, Alda. Mr. Ritchie, did you have anything else you wanted to add?
Well, I think I mentioned that my husband thinks it's an ulcer, but I don't I don't think it's anything serious.
Okay. Well, let me just ask you a couple more questions, all right?
Okay. Example on how you could make this technique work for you. Again, something that I probably need to try or work on a little bit better. The bottom line for all these tips and tricks is really that we need the students are third-year students. They need to have meaningful responsibility. They need to be able to see patients independently, collect data, and make some preliminary decisions. They shouldn't be ordering stuff and doing things independently, obviously, but, you know, reporting back to you and sort of, you know, they need to sort of commit themselves. Yeah, I think this is pneumonia. Or, yeah, I think this might be congestive heart failure. And we're going to watch some of these in a moment. We have some more videos. So what makes a great ambulatory teacher? Really the same thing that makes any kind of a great teacher that you've had, but it's particularly communicating expectations, so telling them what you expect ahead of time, picking the right patients for them that are appropriate to their level of learning, being enthusiastic, being a skillful clinician, which all of you are, and role modeling, being a good role model, and giving them feedback, and not overwhelming them with too many teaching points. Maybe just one teaching point every time you have a case is plenty for them to absorb. Other tips are, you know, again, matching their ability with the patients. So in July, the less complicated patients, by the time this time of the year rolls around, November, December, they should be able to pick up as complex patients as you have. And ways for you to teach on the fly, asking, tell me what you think and why. That student that we just said, you know, we are all thinking it's probably GERD that she has, right? Or at least the internists in the audience and the family medicine docs. So have her commit. Tell me what you think's wrong with this lady. Sometimes you could give a mini lecture, like, I'll tell you what I know, I'll tell you what I think we should do, or thinking out loud about your own clinical reasoning. So this is why I think this is a reflux. After you go over the case, saying to the patient, so what do you need to read? What do you need to learn to go next time you see a case like this to know better about it? Or actually saying, I think you need to look this up. So this is a model called the MicroSkills model. That's a very popular educational tool for teaching in ambulatory settings. And it really is just a lot of the things we've already talked about, but I'm going to show you a clip that kind of rolls everything into one. Basically getting a commitment from the learner. What do you think is going on with the patient and why? Then sort of probing them. Well, why do you think it's congestive heart failure? Is the history consistent with that? And then reinforcing at the end, what did the learner really do right in the case? And then correcting if they made any mistakes. And here's a little clip. The gentleman on the right is about to come and be our new Associate Dean for Academic Affairs, by the way. His name is Maurice Clifton. So you'll be meeting him in person. He's got a little more gray hair than in this clip, but go ahead and roll it.
Patient in the walk-in clinic. She's a 25-year-old female here for abdominal pain.
Okay.
Her pain started late last night after dinner. She describes as being a 7 out of 10 in intensity, somewhat vague, but mostly around her umbilicus. She said she had several episodes of nausea and vomiting, and she thought it was something that she ate. But then overnight, her pain worsened and sort of localized to the right lower quadrant. She says she felt feverish, but she never took her temperature. And she doesn't have any urinary symptoms. And she hasn't had any diarrhea, but she also hasn't had a bowel movement since yesterday. Her past medical history is otherwise unremarkable, and she hasn't had any sick contacts. On exam, her temperature is 39.5. Heart rate was 120. She looks really uncomfortable. She's lying on her side with her knees flexed up, and she's not really moving a whole lot. Her abdomen's very tender, and she complains with even, like, the slightest pressure, and her pain seems to be localized to the right lower quadrant, and it's positive for rebound and guarding. The rest of her exam was pretty much unremarkable.
Okay, so what do you think is going on with this patient?
I think she probably has appendicitis.
Okay, and what makes you think that she has appendicitis?
She kind of has a classic history for appendicitis with peri-umbilical pain that migrates down to the right lower quadrant, fever, and the right lower quadrant pain associated with rebound and guarding.
I agree. It sounds like a classic case of appendicitis. Some of the other things that are dangerous to miss would be something involving pregnancy or PID. So did you get a sexual history on her?
I did not.
Okay, so that's something we should do. We should probably do a pelvic exam before the surgeons come down to see you. I think you did a great job of presenting the patient. You were very smooth in your presentation. You went through and everything was in the right place, in the right order, which is nice. Made it really easy for me to follow along. You did a good exam. I think the only thing is, again, not talking about sexual history and the possibility of PID, and that could make us look kind of silly when the surgeons come down.
Okay.
Basically, that was just a great example of, you know, making the student commit. What do you think's wrong? Appendicitis. Okay, why? And then giving the student some really good feedback about, well, you didn't take a sexual history and you didn't do a pelvic exam and you really need to think. So, you know, the student would obviously learn an awful lot from that case. So, committing, what do you think's wrong? Why do you think that? Always do this when you see a similar case. So, you know, when you see a woman with lower abdominal pain, you need to do a pelvic exam and consider gynecologic diagnoses. But then reinforcing what they did right. That was a great presentation. And you did, you know, it sounds like you did uncover, you know, a classic history potentially for appendicitis. Educational prescriptions are a really neat thing to do. And we have a form for this, and some people will carry this around their pocket. So when you uncover sort of a deficiency or a gap maybe in the student's knowledge, you can help them to maybe even assign themselves, or you can assign them an educational prescription, just like you would do a prescription for the patient. And here's a little video of the same doctor giving the student a educational prescription.
Okay, do you have any questions?
What are they going to do with her when she gets to the emergency room?
Well, if you were there, what do you think you'd do?
I don't know, maybe I'd get like a CBC or an x-ray or something like that.
Okay, and what would you be looking for in an x-ray?
Or maybe not an x-ray, but like a CT scan.
Okay, so how useful is a CT in diagnosing appendicitis?
I don't know.
Well, it sounds like that might be a good learning point for you. And so what we can do is, I'll just write an educational prescription for you.
Okay.
And tell me, you know, what do you think the question is?
How to evaluate appendicitis, how useful a CT is.
The second question is more specific, and it'll probably be easier to find good data on that.
Okay.
So CT and appendicitis. So the thing to do is to write down what the information is that you find, and also where you find it. And then also with the information that comes up, how relevant is it, how valid are the results, and also how this will change what you do for your patient.
Okay.
And then we'll talk about it tomorrow at the end of clinic, okay?
Okay.
So tomorrow, end of clinic. Any questions about this? Okay.
No, that sounds good.
Great.
Thank you.
And I would encourage you, those that will be working with the third year students, to, you know, you're going to be seeing them once a week in your office, right? So give them an assignment for the next week based on one of the cases that they saw. You know, it shouldn't be something that's going to take them, you know, 8 hours, but, you know, it could take them 1 hour to get back to you with a very focused topic. So how do you give feedback? What if a student's way off base? You know, I think we saw some very good role modeling of how to give constructive feedback. Not so much you ordered that, but next time, you know, maybe you could do this better. And again, when complimenting somebody, it only is very helpful if you're giving them positive feedback if it's kind of specific, like, you know, you did a good job noticing the possible role of medication side effects in the diagnosis. This might have helped us avoid some unnecessary tests. No, you know, not strong work. That doesn't really give them much information, or you did a great job. So here's a sample, and we're getting toward the end because I know we're running a little late. So, but this is a video of just how to give maybe constructive feedback.
So you correctly identified the left lower lobe infiltrate on the chest x-ray. And along with the clinical picture, I do agree with you that this is probably a pneumonia, not a congestive heart failure exacerbation. So what do you think we should do for the patient today?
Well, I think we should probably admit her to the hospital.
Well, it's true that some patients with pneumonia do need to be admitted to the hospital. With this patient, because she's very well, she has a good home situation, and she's not dehydrated, and she can take oral medications, we can probably treat her as an outpatient with an oral antibiotic. There's some really good clinical prediction rules that help us to decide that. We look at things like patient's age, their comorbidities, and some indices that tell us how ill they are or how sick they are with the pneumonia. So what I'd like you to do for next week, Kristen, is to read a little bit about that. And then just write up a one-pager for me, talking, you know, just basically explaining how would we decide who with pneumonia needs to come into the hospital or not. Okay?
And that's just another example of an educational prescription based on maybe a knowledge gap or a knowledge deficiency that you and the student have uncovered together. What about documentation and notes? This always comes up as a question. You actually can use the student's review of systems and past family and social histories as yours. What you can't do is refer to the student's documentation of physical exam or medical decision making. So all of you are going to help us, and some of you have had surveys that we've asked you, do you have an electronic chart? Because you all know from your experience that it's great for the student's education if they can write notes in the chart. So we'll be working through with how to do that without, you know, keeping us all out of trouble. But basically, you can use parts of the student's note. And what we did in my practice, we had an electronic health record. The student would document it in the nurse's section. And then if I liked what they said, I could cut and paste it into my note and then finish my note, just their review systems, past family, social histories. You can refer to the student's complete note. So if the student wrote a complete note in your office and you're dictating later, you can refer to that and use it to help jog your memory. And there was a study actually that showed having a student in the office saved about 3 minutes of charting time per patient. I don't know if that's true, but it's a nice thing to hang our hats on, maybe. So I will end with this quote. Thank you for your attention. I would have liked to have this been a little more interactive, but we're videotaping it, so. But the best teachers do not necessarily impart more factual knowledge, facts which, unfortunately, let's face it, might be obsolete in just a few years, but rather they engender a learning climate that makes learning fun, enjoyable, and exciting. And I know that you're all going to do that. And I thank you for your early volunteering for the third year. And at this time, I'll entertain any questions.